Let's talk more about this. Now joining us here in the studio is Israel's ambassador to the Philippines, Menashe Bar-On. Good afternoon, Ambassador. Thanks for joining us this afternoon. All right, a ceasefire is in effect. Apparently, it's holding. But, you know, years, even decades of conflict has caused mistrust between and among Israelis and Palestinians. Now, the question is, how can we cure this mistrust and make both parties believe that this ceasefire that's in effect will really hold?
You know, we left Gaza 7 years ago in 2005, which the hope that the Palestinians will take this golden egg in their hand and the virtue of their life. Unfortunately, the Hamas, which is a terrorist organization recognized by international community, took over in Gaza from the Palestinian Authority, and since then Gaza became as a place which we can say the organized terrorist organizations build their power there with the support of other countries like Iran, Syria, and Sudan. This is something which can only create this stability in the region. Mm. And since 2005, Hamas launched more than 16,000 missiles on the southern area of Jerusalem, of Israel. Mm. More than 1 million Israelis under fire every day. I don't know if any other government in the world can accept that their citizens will be always under fire, running from their bed to the shelter, and they have only 20 seconds to do so, to teach the children, our children, from the first day that they're born, how to use the shelter. This is something which no other government can accept. And this operation, the aim of this operation is to stop, to change the rule. And we hope that this ceasefire will bring a different era, or another era, for the Palestinians also.
Mm-hmm. All right, now you talked about training children how to go to the shelter, and that's not normal for any child to learn at a very young age. But in southern Israel, for example, in a town called Sderot. Yeah. They're very wary of the ceasefire as we speak, because southern Israelis are thinking that, you know, things will go back to how they were, and even worse, if the ceasefire doesn't hold. They're skeptical about this ceasefire. What can you say about that?
You know, Israel is a democratic country, and each one of us has his own view. He can express his ideas. And it is the first time since 67 that all the citizens of Israel, almost all, 90% I can say, back the government and ask the government to bring peace to the region, and not to stop this operation until the organizations, the terrorist organization, will accept a ceasefire. We hope now that with the role of Egypt and President Morsi, we will have a chance to change the climate in the area. And the Palestinians, and not all the Palestinians in Gaza are terrorists, not at all. This organization can lead their people to a different era and accept us as a nation among nations, accept us as a state in the region, and we can, both of us, the Palestinians and the Israelis, can have a different and better future for all of us.
Okay. Now, you mentioned Egypt and its role. Let's talk about the U.S. as well, and the whole international community. What would the role of the international community, including Egypt and U.S., be to make sure that, number one, this ceasefire holds, and number two, that this leads to lasting peace in the region?
Well, let's just say the international community, well, the EU, they understood our right for self-defense. And this is under the international law, even. And with this support, with this initiative, with this the stand of the international community behind the ceasefire, we hope that they will stop smuggling arms to the Gaza Strip, and to assist the Palestinians to rebuild together their future and their economy in the region.
Mm-hmm. All right, now, A lot has been said about how this ceasefire might not take effect from both ends, that if one strikes the other, then fighting will begin again. What will make this ceasefire hold?
No, we show for the last 4 years, we show a lot of willingness to stop the Hamas of launching rockets. Several times we went to Security Council, United Nations Security Council. Several times we advert about that. We warned the international community about the situation. We ask that, and we say that this cannot continue. And once we exercise our self-defense, suddenly, they realize that the other side of the equation, the Israelis, also suffering. So we hope now with this ceasefire, we hope that they will understand that by force they can't kick us off from the region, they can't throw us to the sea, and better to join forces to a better life, better situation, economic situation, and you can see the difference between the West Bank and Gaza. The West Bank is. The situation is different in Gaza. Why? Because the Palestinians in the West Bank understood that through negotiation, through building a situation which can change their economic life there, they can have better life. Mm-hmm. And they understood for the last at least 10 years. Yes, we have a disagreement with the Palestinians. To reach a peace between us, it's not something easy. We know that there's that issue which is important for them, and the other issue is important for us. And once they will understand that we must compromise, I am sure that we can have peace in the region.
Okay. What makes this ceasefire different from all the other ceasefires that were declared historically?
Well, you know, we had this rendezvous, I can say, with the Hezbollah in the north. Well, Hezbollah in the north, it's becoming part of state of Lebanon. So, and since 2006, we have the Hezbollah there. We know what they have, but since then, there are no clashes between. Lebanon, I can say, and Israel. We hope that Egypt will assist the Palestinian Authority in this part of the region in Gaza, and to have security, and I can say quiet borders, like with the West Bank.
Mm-hmm. All right, now let's move forward now and talk about forging really lasting peace in the region beyond this ceasefire. How can that be achieved? Is it a matter of Hamas just laying down their arms and just as you put them?
Leadership. It's a matter of leadership. You know, we in Israel today, more than 70% understood that the solution in the region is two-state solution. One state for the Palestinians, mm-hmm. and one said for the Jewish people. We said that Palestinians who wish to go back to the region, they can do so to the Palestinian state, and Jewish can do so to the Israeli state, Jewish state. Once they will accept that, I think that we can say that at least halfway, we can reach halfway to world peace. But they still want the law of return. They want that 4.5 million Palestinians, they said that they have 4.5 million Palestinians, to return to the ancient Palestine before 1947. This is something which cannot happen. Nobody in Israel and the world can accept that.
So to your mind, if that's what they want, then forget about peace, because that's never going to happen, as you said. Because if they still want that.
Of course it cannot happen. So what we need is leadership. Leadership, we can say the truth. The Palestinians, that if they want to have their own state, to live in peace with side by side Israel, they must accept that.
But then again, forgive me, Ambassador, for saying this, that you're saying that they need leadership that's going to tell them the truth, but truth according to Israelis.
No, according to the situation, according to the reality, according to the international understanding. The international understanding is something, this something cannot be achieved. Nobody will accept that. So once they will say that they are their own people, look, this we cannot achieve. It's leadership, like you know, Saddam, Anwar Sadat, he make a decision.
And how soon do you think both sides can reach this decision?
Well, as soon as possible. You know, it's better for all of us. I mean, it's we know that. In external forces, extreme forces in the region, they doing all they can not to give us in the region, not only in Israel, in the region to prosper and to have peace between us.
Mm-hmm. You know, Ambassador, we have about 41,000 Filipinos working in Israel, and as I understand, it's considered to be one of the largest group of immigrant workers in Israel. How is that going to matter into forging peace between Israel and Hamas? What stake does the Filipino community there have?
The Filipino caregivers in Israel are very welcomed. You know, the elderly people in Israel ask Filipinos to come to assist them. We treat the foreigners in Israel as the same as in Israelis, and if they need assistance in a situation similar situation in the future, of course they will receive the same as my children receives in Israel. So there is no distinction between foreigners and Israelis in emergency situations. We hope to have them to have the Filipinos in Israel for as much as they needed, you know.
What role has the Filipino community there played in so far as the economy in the region?
We consider the caregivers in Israel as a very important issue to in the third age, when the third age needs help, and we found this mechanism that to bring caregivers to be with them, rather and the government can assist them from financing their stay in Israel. It's something which we are welcome. The role is very important in our economy, and we are welcome the Filipinos to be part of the labor force in Israel. We have a lot of talks with the local authorities in the Philippines to officialize through agreements the recruitment of caregivers in Israel.
Of course, if there's lasting peace in the region, then an uninterrupted work or contracts will stay for the Filipino community. That's why I asked you that question as well, because if there's war and they're forced to come home, there's about 41,000 families that may be affected here at home because of what's happening there in Israel.
We hope that something like that will not happen, but we can assure any foreigner who lives in Israel, work in Israel, that he will have all the protection, protected as any other citizen in Israel.
Okay, that's a final question, Ambassador Baron. Where do we go from here? After the ceasefire has been declared, what's the next step?
I can say, it depends only on the terrorist organizations. If they must change their manifesto, they must recognize Israel, they must recognize that they can't achieve their to change their status or to give better life to the Palestinians through war. It's something which is we had it in the past several times for the last 65 years, and we are in a situation which we need to decide. The decision must be accepting Israel as a state in the region, two-state solution, and let's talk about other issues which we can resolve.
All right. Israel's ambassador to the Philippines, Menashe Baron, we appreciate you joining us this afternoon.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, we're going to take a break now. Coming up on the Bureau, thousands of Egyptians take to the streets protesting against a precedent. And also when we come back, new associates.